Elif Batuman had made her reputation until now as an essayist and critic for just over the last decade by virtue of her strong convictions, biting wit, and a capacity for a very interesting kind of self-interrogation that veers between self-doubt and self-actualization on the page. She is a writer who can make a tour of her thinking about a thing into a fully realized drama. She began publishing in N+1 and was quickly hired as a staff writer at The New Yorker, where she has produced compelling journalism about modern Turkey and ancient Turkey also. In 2010, she published her best-selling debut collection of essays, The Possessed, Adventures with Russian Books and the People Who Read Them, which detailed her own education in comparative literature and her research into Russian literature as a sort of madcap adventure among the classics and those who have spent a life studying them. She has won a Whiting Award and the Paris Review's Terry Southern Prize for Humor in the process, and became known as a part of a group of writers who ushered in the golden age of the essay, as it was called recently. And so she has, of course, turned her attention to writing fiction. Now she has produced her debut novel, The Idiot, which, for those who already know Batuman's work, has a feeling of returning to the familiar ground of The Possessed. But you couldn't ask for any better education in the difference between fiction and nonfiction than to read the two beside each other. Batuman, as a novelist, is, simply put, more than willing to betray her main character, Selin, in a way she never was able to betray herself as an essayist, working within the limits of her own identity. Selin is not, certainly, Batuman, make no mistake. And the novel's beginning with Selin discovering that she must use this new technology called email to communicate announces to us that she is a way of thinking through the modern age in some new way that Batuman has not done for us before now. Please welcome Elif Batuman.
Thank you for that beautiful introduction, and thank you all for being here. So happy to be reading The Idiot for you. So this book is about, it's set during the freshman year at college at Harvard of a Turkish-American young person whose name is Selin. And through the new technology of email, she has this long flirtation slash romance with a Hungarian student who she meets in her Russian class. And one thing leads to another, and she ends up going to Hungary. But she's working as an English teacher at a volunteer program in a village nowhere near the guy who's in Budapest. So I'm gonna read from the part where she's in a village program that sends American college students to teach English in different villages, and she is staying with a woman called Margit, and Margit is a English teacher. Okay, sorry for all that exposition. Margit's household comprised Margit's husband, Jula, their children, Nora and Ferry, and Barka, a dog. There were a lot of cats who weren't allowed inside. Nora had given them all names, which only she knew. Margit's physical type was familiar to me, but Jula didn't look like anyone I'd seen before. Sinewy, tan, with a golden mustache, he wore a long-sleeved plaid shirt tucked into denim short shorts and a blue cap with a visor. "Willkommen," he said, lifting my suitcase out of the trunk and carrying it upstairs. The second floor of the house was a recent addition. The walls of the front room were still crisscrossed with wooden beams and pink insulation fluff, and a plastic sheet was taped over the window frame. But the back room was finished and beautiful, with a yellow carpet, a green sofa bed, a glass-topped desk with a vase of goldenrods, and, standing in the corner, a little snarling stuffed weasel. When Margit saw the weasel, her expression grew strained, and she said something to Jula, who replied at length. My husband thought that your room is very empty, so you might like a little weasel, Margit said, turning to me. We can move it downstairs now. He won't be hurt. It wasn't clear to me who it was that wouldn't be hurt, her husband or the weasel. In either case, it seemed clear to me that if you really wanted to be a writer, you didn't send away the weasel. Are you sure you won't be frightened when you wake up? Margit asked. Oh, no, I said. I was frightened when I woke up. Razor-sharp cucumber slices floated in ice-cold vinaigrette. The beets didn't correspond to any ideas I had previously held. In the middle of dinner, Jula went out the front door, returning with a 1.5-liter Coke bottle full of a kind of inky homemade wine that they kept in the tool shed. Jula filled three heavy tumblers and raised one, and Margit translated what he was saying, that I should consider their house to be my house, and if I woke up hungry in the middle of the night, I should help myself to whatever they had. Margit's manner of speech reminded me of Ivan's, that's the guy, the way she pronounced my name and the questions she asked, like what languages I spoke and what other countries I'd visited. Americans didn't ask such questions. After dinner, it was time to check the fields. The whole family piled into the car. When Jula opened the trunk, Barka jumped right in and lay down like she rode in there all the time. Margit climbed into the back with the children, and I got in the front and put on my seatbelt. Jula started shouting and waving his arms. He says you can trust his driving, Margit said, laughing. He's a very safe driver, and we're not going far. I immediately took off the seatbelt. More hilarity ensued. No, no, Margit said, keep the belt and feel safe. I said that wearing a seatbelt didn't reflect a judgment about safety. It was automatic because at home it was against the law to not wear a seatbelt. This, too, they found hilarious. If we are driving to the fields and a policeman catches us, he might put you in jail. The fields were a few minutes' drive away. Jula took a shotgun out of the trunk and disappeared into the corn. A female scarecrow lolled on a tall stake, her dress flapping in the wind. Margit said it was her own old dress. It shrank, so Nora and I made a scarecrow. For some reason, Nora gave it a cat's face. Sure enough, the scarecrow had a little cat nose and whiskers. Well, that should be scary for the birds, I said. Unfortunately, our birds are very brave. We walked around the fields, and Margit pointed out the different crops, tobacco, wheat, chickpeas, watermelons, other melons, poppies, grapes, cherries, apples. Back at the house, Margit put the children to bed and then brought out an apple cake she had made. Jula set a bottle of whiskey on the table. I felt embarrassed to eat cake without the children. Margit, who seemed to guess what I was thinking, said that Fairy didn't like cake and Nora had to cut down on sweets, though she was only 7. Did anyone ever get as much of anything that they wanted? Now, said Margit, when Jula had poured the whiskey, tell us all about yourself. But I have, I said. You already know everything about me. Now you will tell us the long version, she said, sitting back in her chair. We have so much time. We have all night. It made such a strong impression on me when she said that. Just for a moment, as if in a flash of lightning, I seemed to glimpse some unseen vista stretching out before me and opening in all directions before it went dark again. Margit asked what I wanted to become after the university. I told her I wanted to become a writer. You'll write a novel about us, she exclaimed. Maybe someday, I said. I was surprised when she asked if I had a boyfriend. I thought it was clear that I wasn't someone who had boyfriends. But when I said I didn't, she seemed disbelieving. I thought maybe you had a Hungarian boyfriend, she said, and that's why you came to Hungary. Oh no, I said, what gave you that idea? I don't know, she said. I suppose it's just something I thought of. The alarm went off at 7:45. I lay in bed a few minutes, puzzling over why exactly I had to get up and teach English to school children now, whether I had made some mistake, and if so, where. I'm actually gonna skip some of the teaching part, because y'all know English. Before that summer, I knew almost nothing about the Beatles. I didn't know why it was important to be a mop top, or what a mop top was. Whenever I heard older people talking about them, I just tuned it out. There were never any bad consequences. I really thought I could go through my whole life that way. But the Beatles turned out to be one of the things you couldn't avoid, like alcohol or death. Wouldn't it be fun to teach the children some Beatles songs? Margit asked on the very first day. When I said I didn't know any, she got one of the girls in the class to loan me a greatest hits compilation, two 90-minute Maxell cassettes with the song titles carefully written on the liner in ballpoint pen. I was troubled by the Beatles, by the contradiction between their jaunty, harmoniously innocent warbling and the calculating, cynical worldview that seemed to underlie it. All the time they had been pleasing that girl, the Beatles had been keeping tally, resenting her for making them show her the way, waiting to be pleased in return. They went on about how they worked like a dog to make money to buy her things. And in exchange, she had to give them everything. What if she didn't? What if she didn't know how? 17 was daunting because of the line that I expected to go, and the way she looked was way beyond her age, but which instead went, or so it seemed to me, and the way she looked was way beyond her man. I was deeply struck by the inequity between the girl and her man, the way it made her vulnerable to the Beatles, even as it indicated that she had already been defeated and humiliated, suckered into going with someone so far below her. At the same time, the fact that she was just 17 and had a man at all meant that youth was no excuse for me for how I was incapable of making anyone drive my car or of telling the Beatles things they wanted to know or of evoking in them or anyone else the feelings they described, the feelings that Ivan must have felt for his girlfriend 8 days a week. Okay, after school the next day, Margit had to take the children somewhere, so Jula came and picked me up and brought me back to the house. The house was empty when we got back. I started to head upstairs, but Jula led me to the table and pulled out a chair, and the next thing I knew, he'd brought out the whiskey again. "Marlboro," he suggested, taking a pack from his pocket. But the idea of smoking cigarettes with an adult was too strange, and I declined the Marlboro as well as the whiskey. Jula looked thoughtful, then went outside to the shed and came back with an orange tackle box and removed two stacked trays from the upper compartment. They were full of ammunition, bullets and cartridges and birdshot, neatly arranged in compartments. He took out several cartridges and stood them upright on the table. "German," he said. "American, like you." Even the bullets here had nationalities. There were Czech, Finnish, Yugoslavian, and Chinese bullets. "Soviet bullet," he said in Russian, tapping a domed cartridge with a red band. Holding up one of the German cartridges, Jula twitched his nose and made scampering noises with his hands. Then he beat his palms against his legs in a way that sounded just like wings and expelled a stream of air through his teeth. From these gestures, I understood eventually that the little German cartridge was for shooting rabbits and pheasants. Standing a larger American cartridge on the table, Jula closed his eyes for a moment, then placed his index fingers pointing upward against his temples, opened his eyes wide, and turned his head sharply from side to side. "Özbek," he said. That turned out to be a Roebuck. He took out a third cartridge, really different from the other two, brass-plated, reminiscent of a pen. He looked at me for a moment. "Mensch," he said, lowering his voice. Then, in Hungarian, "man." Jula told a hunting story. There was a roebuck in it, and Barka, and the police, and a confrontation, and barking. He repeatedly praised Barka and said she was a Wisla, and imitated the way she pointed with her foot. He produced some papers from the bottom compartment of the box. Bistositash, he said. Do you understand? Bistositash. I looked up bistositash. It meant insurance. When he saw I had a dictionary, Jula told me some other words for gun registration, hunting license, and gun license. The most important point seemed to be that you needed two licenses, one for you and one for the gun. Two licenses, I repeated. He nodded and said that I was clever. The Ford Fiesta pulled up outside and the children ran in, followed a moment later by Margit. Oh dear, said Margit, taking in the bottle of whiskey, the open tackle box, and the array of bullets and licenses. It seems there has been a lecture. The next afternoon, Margit and Jula were both busy, so the school principal gave me a ride home. I found myself alone for the first time in days. Remembering that they had said I could eat whatever I wanted, I cut a big slice of apple cake and ate it while reading Dracula. It felt amazing to eat anything without having to listen, nod, smile, or do anything with my eyebrows. Dracula visited the wolf department at the zoological gardens. The wolves seem upset about something, he observed. The next morning, the cage was all twisted out of shape, and the gray wolf, Berserker, was missing. Dracula had temporarily inhabited its body. Dracula had a totally different experience at the zoo from that of other people. Someone was knocking on the glass door. The main door was open, and behind the glass stood a small blonde girl. Hello, I said. Hello, she said. I am Rennie. We will go on an excursion. I opened the door. She came in, but wouldn't sit down, and only glanced at her tiny watch, its face no bigger than a nickel. She didn't seem interested in cake either. She just kept saying we would go on an excursion. Okay, I said. I got up and started to clear the table. We will go on an excursion now. Now? Like right now? Yes, of course. I noticed then that she was wearing a tiny backpack with both straps on. I suppressed a sigh. Hungary felt increasingly like reading War and Peace. New characters came up every 5 minutes with their with their unusual names and distinctive locutions, and you had to pay attention to them for a time, even though you might never see them again for the whole rest of the book. I would rather have talked to Ivan, the love interest, but somehow I didn't get to decide. At the same time, I also felt that these super abundant personages weren't irrelevant at all, but somehow the opposite, and that when Ivan had told me to make friends with the other kids, he'd been telling me something important about the world, about how the fateful character in your life wasn't the one who buried you under a rock, but the one who led you out to more people. I'm gonna stop there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Viet Thanh Nguyen began his career as a fiction writer in a grand style. With his best-selling debut novel, The Sympathizer, the winner of the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction, the Andrew Carnegie Medal for Fiction, the Center for Fiction First Novel Prize, the Edgar Award for the First Novel, the Asian Pacific American Award for Literature, the California Award for First Fiction, and the Dayton Literary Peace Prize. The Sympathizer is a mole's confession. An unnamed man is writing to someone he only ever calls the Commandant. And he is taking his measure of his role in Vietnam during the war. This novel has been compared to the work of Graham Greene, Joseph Conrad, John le Carré, and brilliantly occupies the tropes of those well-known war novels. But Nguyen sets himself apart by writing from the perspective of what his narrator calls a between, mixed as he is, half Vietnamese and half white, a position these writers never sought to understand. And the result is a gripping new story of the Vietnam War that only he could tell. He followed this novel up with his meditation on the Vietnam War, a nonfiction book, Nothing Ever Dies, which was a finalist for the National Book Award. In that book, Nguyen sought to examine the various portrayals of the Vietnam War in fiction, film, monuments, and even prisons, considering the public face of the war as it exists for Americans. Nguyen is the Aaron Arnold Professor of English and American Studies and Ethnicity at the University of Southern California. He's also the author of Race and Resistance. This year sees him returning with a collection of stories already widely hailed, The Refugees, in which Nguyen returns his attention to those who may have left Vietnam for America but have not entirely left the country or the war behind them. Please welcome Viet Thanh Nguyen.
Hi. Well, hello, New York. It's great to be back here. I came from LA. It's not actually great to be back here in the middle of a blizzard. As Alexander said in his very generous introduction, I have a new book out called The Refugees, and I'm going to be talking about refugees tonight. So I thought I'd start off with actually a very brief excerpt from The Sympathizer, where I do talk about refugees. And The Sympathizer is about this communist spy, and one of the things that happens to him is that he becomes a refugee and comes to California. And in this scene, he is writing a letter to his aunt in Paris describing what life is like in this refugee camp in San Diego. If allowed to stay together, I told my aunt, we could have incorporated ourselves into a respectably sized, self-sufficient colony, a pimple on the buttocks of the American body politic, sufficiently collective to elect our own representative to the Congress and have a voice in our America, a little Saigon as delightful, delirious, and dysfunctional as the original, which was exactly why we were not allowed to stay together, but were instead dispersed by bureaucratic fiat. Wherever we found ourselves, we found each other. We did our best to conjure up the culinary staples of our culture, but since we were dependent on Chinese markets, our food had an unacceptably Chinese tinge. Another blow in the gauntlet of our humiliation that left us with a sweet and sour taste of unreliable memories. Just correct enough to evoke the past, just wrong enough to remind us that the past was forever gone, missing along with the proper variety, subtlety, and complexity of our universal solvent, fish sauce. Oh, fish sauce. How we missed it. How nothing tasted right without it. This pungent liquid condiment of the darkest sepia hue was much denigrated by foreigners for its supposedly horrendous reek, lending new meaning to the phrase, there's something fishy around here. For we were the fishy ones. We used fish sauce the way Transylvanian villagers wore cloves of garlic to ward off vampires. In our case, to establish a perimeter with those Westerners who could never understand that what was truly fishy was the nauseating stench of cheese. What was fermented fish compared to curdled milk? But out of deference to our hosts, we kept our feelings to ourselves, sitting close to one another on prickly sofas and scratchy carpets, our knees touching under crowded kitchen tables, chewing on dried squid and the cud of remembrance until our jaws ached, trading stories heard second and third hand about our scattered countrymen. This was the way we learned of the Klan turned into slave labor by a farmer in Modesto, and the naive girl who flew to Spokane to marry her GI sweetheart and was sold to a brothel, and the widower with nine children who went out into a Minnesotan winter and lay down in the snow on his back with his mouth wide open until he was buried and frozen, and the regretful refugees on Guam who petitioned to go back to Vietnam, never to be heard from again. And the spoiled girl seduced by heroin who disappeared into the Baltimore streets, and the devout Buddhist who spanked his young son and was arrested for child abuse in Houston, and the husband who slapped his wife and was jailed for domestic violence in Raleigh, and the men who had escaped but left wives behind in the chaos, and the women who had escaped but left husbands behind, and the children who had escaped without parents and grandparents, and the families missing one, two, three or more children. Sifting through the dirt we pan for gold, the story of the baby orphan adopted by a Kansas billionaire, or the mechanic who bought a lottery ticket in Arlington and became a multimillionaire, or the girl elected president of her high school class in Baton Rouge, or the boy accepted by Harvard from Fond du Lac, the soil of Camp Pendleton still in the tracks of his sneakers, or the movie star you love so much, dear aunt, who circled the world from airport to airport, no country letting her in after the fall of Saigon, none of her American movie star friends returning her desperate phone calls until, with her last dime, she snagged Tippi Hedren, who flew her to Hollywood. So it was that we soaped ourselves in sadness and we rinsed ourselves with hope. And for all that we believed almost every rumor we heard, almost all of us refused to believe that our nation was dead. So the story about the movie star is actually a true story. Her name was Giu Jin, and she was the most famous movie star in Vietnam in the 1960s and 1970s. And Tippi Hedren, in coming into contact with these Vietnamese refugees in San Diego, felt such sympathy for them that she had her personal manicurist train some of these women in the arts of the manicure, which is how now, 40 years later, Vietnamese people have come to own 51% of the nail salon industry in this country. Which is either a pro-refugee story or an anti-refugee story, depending on your point of view. And obviously, this whole question of being pro-refugee or anti-refugee is very much on my mind. Being a refugee myself and living in a climate now where we, at least some of us in this country, are turning against refugees. And one of the interesting things that happened when The Sympathizer came out was that people often referred to it as an immigrant story and me as an immigrant writer. And I've had to be very explicit and say, no, I'm not an immigrant, I'm a refugee, and this is not an immigrant novel, it's a war novel, or it's a refugee novel, or it's both. And I think it's really important for me to draw attention to that repeatedly because I'm working against something that's really strong in the American consciousness, and that's this idea that we are a nation of immigrants. Now, it's true that at this moment, there are many people in this country who don't want to accept immigrants. And in the history of this country, we've gone back and forth. Sometimes we want immigrants, sometimes we don't want immigrants. And for a considerable portion of this country, 1882 to about 1965, the doors of this country were mostly closed to people who were not white. And then for a 50-year period, we've been living in a time when we have been welcoming people from all over the world, and now we are not. But the point is that even as this pendulum goes back and forth, this idea that we're a country of immigrants remains really important to the American mythology, to the American dream. So to call The Sympathizer an immigrant novel and me an immigrant writer incorporates me and the novel into this mythology. And it prevents people from thinking about how it is that there's a distinction between immigrants and refugees and why it is that when we have Vietnamese refugees in this country, the reason why they're here is because of a war that the United States fought somewhere else. And that's an uncomfortable history for a lot of people to confront. And refugees are an uncomfortable people for a lot of Americans or Europeans to confront, because immigrants come with the promise of succeeding in the American dream, of wanting to be here. And refugees seem to bring with them contamination, threat, instability. And it's important for me to keep talking about it because no one would look at me and think, well, there's a refugee. You know, because I think I've made the successful transition from refugee to bourgeoisie a long time ago. And even though I was in a camp in Fort Indiantown Gap in Pennsylvania, I have now gone from camps to clubs. I mean, it's true. I get invited to all kinds of clubs now that I would have been invited to a few years ago. So I've given readings in the Ronald Reagan room, of all places, in one of these elite clubs. So I'm the child of Ronald Reagan now. So it's been very important then for me to also take out and stake out a non-fictional claim outside of my fiction to assert how it is that some of my work can be read, especially in this climate. So I just wanted to read briefly an excerpt from an essay that I wrote called America and Me that I published a few weeks ago in the Financial Times, speaking about my own experience as a refugee, since I get asked about it basically in every single interview that I do. So I'll just, you know, answer your questions in advance. I'm a refugee, an American, and a human being, which is important to proclaim, as there are many who think these identities cannot be reconciled. In March 1975, as Saigon was about to fall or be on the brink of liberation, depending on your point of view, my humanity was temporarily put into question as I became a refugee. My family lived in Ban Metuit, famous for its coffee and for being the first town overrun by communist invasion. My father was in Saigon on business, and my mother had no way to contact him. She took my 10-year-old brother and 4-year-old me, and we walked 184 kilometers to the nearest port in Yajang. I admit to possibly being carried. At least it was downhill. At least I was too young, unlike my brother, to remember the dead paratroopers hanging from the trees. I'm grateful not to remember the terror and the chaos that must have been involved in finding a boat. We made it to Saigon and reunited with my father. And a month later, when the communists arrived, repeated the mad scramble for our lives. That summer, we arrived in America. I came to understand that in the United States, land of the fabled American dream, it is un-American to be a refugee. The refugee embodies fear, failure, and flight. Americans of all kinds believe that it is impossible for an American to become a refugee, although it is possible for refugees to become Americans, and in that way be elevated one step closer to heaven. The average American or European who feels that refugees or immigrants threaten their jobs does not recognize that the real culprits for their economic plight are the corporate interests and the individuals that want to take the profits and are perfectly happy to see the struggling pitted against each other. The economic interests of the unwanted and the fearful middle class are aligned. But so many can't see that because of how much they fear the different, the refugee, the immigrant. In its most naked form, this is racism. In a more polite form, it takes the shape of defending one's culture, where one would rather remain economically poor but ethnically pure. This fear is a powerful force, and I admit to being afraid of it. Then I think of my parents, who were younger than me, when they lost nearly everything and became refugees. I can't help but remember how, after we settled in San Jose, California, and my parents opened a Vietnamese grocery store in the run-down downtown, a neighboring store put a sign up in its window: another American driven out of business by the Vietnamese. But my parents did not give in to fear, even though they must have been afraid. And I think of my son, nearly the age I was when I became a refugee. And while I do not want him to be afraid, I know he will be. What is important is that he have the strength to overcome his fear. And the way to overcome fear is to demand the America that should be and can be, the America that dreams the best version of itself. So when I think back to that sign, another American driven out of business by the Vietnamese, there's a story behind that message. And there's a story behind the message, make America great again. And that story, both of those stories, excludes people like me. Because America was not great for me before. America could be great if we try to make it so. And for me, the only way that I know how to make America great is through telling stories. It's the challenge these kinds of stories about Vietnamese not being a part of this country, about America having been great at one time but not great today. And so that's why I write stories. And I think that all of us have the potential to tell those stories, even if we don't write these kinds of stories, to take America back. I'll tell a competing story. So that's why one of the reasons why I wrote The Refugees. I grew up in the United States, I grew up in California, and I watch, I think, almost every movie that Hollywood made about the Vietnam War, which is an exercise I do not recommend to anybody. Because, especially for a young Vietnamese person, what it confirmed for me was that the only place in the American story that I had as a Vietnamese person was to be shot, to be raped, to be rescued, or if I had anything to say thank you. So I'm not the kind of person who says thank you. This story then that I'm going to read from The Refugees, the whole book The Refugees is about then putting forth the stories of Vietnamese people who have something to say. This, what I'm going to read is from the opening story, Black Eyed Women. Fame would strike someone, usually the kind that healthy-minded people would not wish upon themselves, such as being kidnapped and kept prisoner for years, humiliated in a sex scandal, or surviving something typically fatal. These survivors needed someone to help write their memoirs, and their agents might eventually come across me. "At least your name's not on anything," my mother once said. When I mentioned that I would not mind being thanked in the acknowledgments, she said, "Let me tell you a story." It would be the first time I heard this story, but not the last. "In our homeland," she went on, "there was a reporter who said the government tortured the people in prison. So the government does to him exactly what he said they did to others. They send him away and no one ever sees him again. That's what happens to writers who put their names on things." By the time Victor Devoto chose me, I had resigned myself to being one of those writers whose names did not appear on book covers. His agent had given him a book that I had ghostwritten, its ostensible author the father of a boy who had shot and killed several people at his school. "I identify with the father's guilt," Victor said to me. He was the sole survivor of an airplane crash, 173 others having perished, including his wife and children. What was left of him appeared on all the talk shows, his body there, but not much else. The voice was a soft monotone, and the eyes, on the occasions they looked up, seemed to hold within them the silhouettes of mournful people. His publisher said that it was urgent that he finish his story while audiences still remembered the tragedy, and this was my preoccupation on the day my dead brother returned to me. My mother woke me while it was still dark outside and said, "Don't be afraid." Through my open door, the light from the hallway stung. Why would I be afraid? When she said my brother's name, I did not think of my brother. He had died long ago. I closed my eyes and said, "I did not know anyone by that name." But she persisted. "He's here to see us," she said, stripping off my covers and tugging at me until I rose, eyes half shut. She was 63, moderately forgetful, and when she led me to the living room and cried out, I was not surprised. "He was right here," she said, kneeling by her floral armchair as she felt the carpet. "It's wet." She crawled to the front door in her cotton pajamas, following the trail. When I touched the carpet, it was damp. For a moment, I twitched in belief, and the silence of the house at 4 a.m. felt ominous. Then I noticed a sound of rainwater in the gutters, and the fear that had gripped my neck relaxed its hold. My mother must have opened the door, gotten drenched, then come back inside. I knelt by her as she crouched next to the door, her hand on the knob, and said, "You're imagining things." "I know what I saw." Brushing my hand off her shoulder, she stood up, anger illuminating her dark eyes. "He walked, he talked, he wanted to see you." "Then where is he, Ma? I don't see anyone." "Of course you don't," she sighed, as if I were the one unable to grasp the obvious. He's a ghost, isn't he? Ever since my father died a few years ago, my mother and I lived together politely. We shared a passion for words, but I preferred the silence of writing, while she loved to talk. She constantly fed me gossip and stories, the only kind I enjoyed, concerning my father back when he was a man I did not know, young and happy. Then came stories of terror, like the one about the reporter, the moral being that life, like the police, enjoys beating people now and again. Finally, there was her favorite kind, the ghost story, of which she knew many, some firsthand. Aunt Six died of a heart attack at 76, she told me once, twice, or perhaps three times, repetition being her habit. I never took her stories seriously. She lived in Vung Tao and we were in Yajang. I was bringing dinner to the table when I saw Aunt Six sitting there in her nightgown. Her long gray hair, which she usually wore in a chignon, was loose and fell over her shoulders and her face. I almost dropped the dishes. When I asked her what she was doing here, she just smiled. She stood up, kissed me, and turned me toward the kitchen. When I turned around again to see her, she was gone. It was her ghost. Uncle confirmed it when I called. She had passed away that morning in her own bed. Aunt Six died a good death, according to my mother, at home and with family, her ghost simply making the rounds to say farewell. My mother repeated her aunt's story while we sat at the kitchen table the morning she claimed to have seen my brother, her son. I had brewed her a pot of green tea and taken her temperature despite her protests, the result being, as she had predicted, normal. Waving the thermometer at me, she said he must have disappeared because he was tired. After all, he had just completed a journey of thousands of miles across the Pacific. So how did he get here? He swam. She gave me a pitying look. That's why he was wet. He was an excellent swimmer, I said, humoring her. What did he look like? Exactly the same. It's been 25 years. He hasn't changed at all? They always look exactly the same as when you last saw them. I remembered how he looked the last time, and any humor that I felt vanished. The stunned look on his face, the open eyes that did not flinch even with the splintered board of the boat's deck pressing against his cheek. I did not want to see him again, assuming there was something or someone to see. After my mother left for her shift at the salon, I tried to go back to sleep, but could not. His eyes stared at me whenever I closed my own. Only now was I conscious of not having remembered him for months. I had long struggled to forget him, but just by turning a corner in the world or in my mind, I could run into him, my best friend. From as far back as I can recall, I could hear his voice outside our house calling my name. That was my signal to follow him down our village's lanes and pathways, through jackfruit and mangrove groves to the dikes and fields, dodging shattered palm trees and bomb craters. At the time, this was a normal childhood. Looking back, however, I could see that we had passed our youth in a haunted country. Our father had been drafted, and we feared that he would never return. Before he left, he had dug a bomb shelter next to our house, a sandbagged bunker whose roof was braced by timber. Even though it was hot and airless, dank with the odor of the earth, and alive with the movement of worms, we often went to play there as little children. When we were older, we went to study and tell stories. I was the best student in my school, excellent enough for my teacher to teach me English after hours, lessons I shared with my brother. He, in turn, told me tall tales, folklore, and rumors. When airplanes shrieked overhead and we huddled with my mother in the bunker, he whispered ghost stories in my ear to distract me. Except, he insisted, they were not ghost stories. They were historical accounts from reliable sources. The ancient crones who chewed betel nut and spat its red juice while squatting on their haunches in the market, tending coal stoves or overseeing baskets of wares. Our land's confirmed residents, they said, included the upper half of a Korean lieutenant, launched by a mine into the branches of a rubber tree. A scalped black American, floating in the creek not far from his downed helicopter, his eyes and the exposed half-moon of his brain glistening above the water, and a decapitated Japanese private groping through cassava shrubbery for his head. These invaders came to conquer our land and now would never go home, the old lady said, cackling and exposing lacquered teeth, or so my brother told me. I shivered with delight in the gloom, hearing those black-eyed women with my own ears, and it seemed to me that I would never tell stories like those. Thank you.
Well, the last line of that story is a perfect segue, I think, into my first question, which is, you know, neither of you really had to be fiction writers, or at least so it seems from the outside. Both of you had other careers before writing fiction. So I thought I would begin by asking both of you to answer this question. What made you turn to fiction?
Well, for me, I did do nonfiction for 10 years. And before that, I was in graduate school, so I was preparing to be an academic. And I did, you know, my share of academic writing. But I really always wanted to write novels since I was tiny. I mean, since before I knew what novels were, I wanted to write novels. And in a way, nonfiction happened for me kind of by accident. The first piece that I wrote for N Plus One magazine was about a conference that I worked on at Stanford about the life and work of the Russian Jewish Soviet short story writer Isaac Babel. And I was trying to write an essay about that that had his work in it, because that was what really attracted me to, that was what made the whole story exciting, was how exciting his language was and how exciting the stories were. But it also had, you know, interactions with his relatives who I drove to the airport, and I don't know, like different scholars and the questions over Babel's biography and his life, which was very sad, and, you know, questions of missing manuscripts. And I thought, while it was happening, I thought, oh, this is something I'm gonna put into a novel someday. And then someone asked me to write. I hadn't published any writing at all at that point. And then some friends of mine from college, or classmates of mine from college, were starting a literary magazine, and they asked me to write something for it. And I described this piece I wanted to write, and I was like, I don't know what it's a long short story or a novella or something. They were like, no, it's an essay. That's what an essay is. That's what an essay does. So I was like, okay. So I wrote it as an essay, and then from that I got assignments to write other essays and reported nonfiction, all of which I really enjoyed doing. But I always want to read novels. Like when I go to bed before I go to sleep, I read novels. Novels are what I feel like I'm in dialogue with.
It's the most immediate thing to me. And I never totally saw why wanting to write about things that are, you know, wanting to write about some books or some real writing or, you know, real historical events or even things that happened to me. To me, the novel isn't really about the distance between my life and what it, or the, you know, whether the content is something that could be in an essay or not. The novel, for me, it's about a relationship between, it's about updating, it's a very meta genre, it's about reading novels and then wanting to update them and to put the experience that you have into that kind of form to keep that form going. It's a very kind of technical, internal, and that's what I want to do, and that's always what I wanted to do. So I kind of feel like now I'm finally doing what I set out to do a long time ago.
So you're sort of accidental essayist.
Yes, that's
a deliberate novelist.
Well, I think I wrote my first story when I was in the third grade, and I, you know, grew up wanting to be a writer, maybe of poetry, maybe of fiction, but I didn't think that I would become a literary critic. I don't know of any little kid who thinks, I want to be a literary critic one day. But what happened was I was in college, and it was obvious to me that when I was in college that I was a much better critic than I was a writer. And when I graduated, I had to choose what school to go to, and I chose PhD school in English because I knew I would get into a better program doing that than being a writer. But I was always writing fiction on the side, and the problem for me was that when I finished my PhD, I didn't have the courage to become a fiction writer. You know, to become a fiction writer for me meant I'd have to strike out and make my own way in the world, whereas to be a professor meant I could have a job. And so, I don't want to cast any disparagements on professors, you know, but you know, it's a good job if you can get it, and I got one, you know, so that was nothing to laugh at. And but what that meant was that I always thought of being a professor and being a literary critic as my day job, and that secretly I was going to be this, you know, writer. And I kept working at it and working at it, and eventually what happened is that I got good enough to publish stories and to publish a novel. And for me, the publishing fiction, writing fiction, at least writing The Sympathizer, was so much more enormously emotionally rewarding than writing nonfiction or criticism. It was a rush to do that, and it was a gratifying rush, especially after 14 years of struggling with short stories, which were absolutely horrible, horrible experience to write, you know? But I finally thought, oh, I broke through, I wrote this novel. And to me, you know, a novel is a technical thing, but it's also an emotional thing, at least in terms of writing it. It was such an exhilarating experience. I don't know if I'll ever get that again. But it was an exhilarating experience because I could finally tell the story that I'd been waiting for decades and decades to tell, you know, which was partially my revenge on America for all the ways that it had screwed over Vietnam and the Vietnamese people, especially through storytelling. And I was like, okay, now I can tell stories myself. And that's, I think, that for me was always an aspiration in terms of being a writer, was to tell a story that I felt had not been told before.
They always say to write from your passions, but they're never clear on which ones. And it's so rare when people admit that some of them are revenge. I too have been motivated by revenge.
It's a noble emotion, I think.
No, Mandelstam talks about it. Osip Mandelstam, he calls it literary spite, and he says it's this engine of wonderful creations of genius.
Yeah.
And I think that's true.
So I think what I'm looking for, though, is a kind of your sort of origin stories around, like, so both of you had these long-held aspirations, but for each of you, there had to have been a moment where you thought, okay, now it is time. Now it is time to do it. And that's what I'm after. Can you think about that?
My agent told me, you gotta write a novel. I said, okay, I'm gonna write a novel. I mean, seriously, that's what happened, you know? I was writing these short stories, and again, literally for 14 years, I was writing them, and some of them were getting published, and they had some minor recognition, but they were just horrible, horrible, horrible to write. And that was not an origin moment. To me, that was like the workup, you know? I was like Peter Parker before he got bit by the spider. I know all this because I have to read this story every single night to my son. He's 3.5 years old, and he loves Spider-Man. So then I was just waiting for someone to tell me, I think, you can do this. And if it's something as mundane as the agent saying, that's how you sell books in this city, I was like, okay. And he's a wise man. He was right. And so I wrote the novel. That's the origin.
Yeah, I also have a long, painful, unmoment-like origin moment, which was, so the idiot is actually, it's based on a manuscript that they say it lived in a drawer for 15 years. It only wasn't in the drawer, it was in the cloud because it was in Google Drive. But I wrote it when I was, I wrote it in graduate school. I took a year off to write a novel. And I wrote it, and then I was like, you know, I don't know what the beginning is, I don't know what the end is. And then I broke my arm and I didn't have health insurance, and they called from, you know, Stanford, and they were like, so are you coming back or are you not coming back? I was like, I'm coming back. And then I was there for all of this time writing this dissertation that went on forever. And then I got into the nonfiction writing. And then, you know, I always wanted to write a novel, and I started writing a novel around 2012. And it just kept having flashbacks that went earlier and earlier it was just ludicrous. Like, the book was overdue, and, you know, I had this summer fellowship, and I was like, if I don't finish it by the end of the summer, I'm just gonna be in horrible, dire trouble. And the flashbacks were still going earlier. I was just like writing like a flashback to when the main character was in college, and she's supposed to be in her like mid-30s. Like, why do we need to know what happened to her in college? But anyway, that was what motivated me to open this file and to look at this old thing that I'd written. And then that, actually, my, you know, maybe that's the origin moment, is when I opened that file, because before that, I'd been writing a novel, but the border between that character and the eye of my nonfiction, because I'm in there all the time in the essays. I'm one of those people who just can't stay out. So that person was very similar to the person who is the voice of the novel. But when I looked at this document, which I'd written at that point 15 years earlier, about a time in, you know, about the experiences, the kinds of experiences that I'd had 20 years earlier, it really felt like fiction. It was set in 1995. It's a world that didn't exist anymore. That person didn't exist anymore. And it really felt like fiction, like I could go in there and change things and move things around. And I was freed from shame and from embarrassment the way one isn't when one's writing about oneself, because this was just some kid. Like, I didn't have to feel embarrassed about all the embarrassing stuff that she did. And in fact, those were my favorite parts. And I thought, I'm going to call this book The Idiot. And so that's how that happened.
That's fantastic. Was there a similar moment? Like, how did you find the narrator for The Sympathizer after all of those stories?
It was actually really easy, you know, because I think I'd been thinking about many of the issues that became the novel for a very long time, ever since, again, I was a little boy watching these American war movies about Vietnam. So I've been reading a lot and so on. And so when my agent said, write a novel, I said, okay, spy story. Because there really were spies. And of course, I wanted to write a novel. It was very important to me to write a novel that was actually entertaining. You know, I wanted to write a political novel, I wanted to write a historical novel, I wanted to write a revenge novel, but I also wanted to write an entertaining novel. And the spy genre would just be a great way to put a plot onto all of that. And so I just, you know, sat down and in a couple of weeks or whatever, wrote the synopsis. The hard part actually was finding the opening line and the opening scene. And I spent an entire summer trying out various lines, trying out various scenarios. And then when I got to the line, I'm a spy, a sleeper, a spook, a man of two faces, I thought, that's it. That's the voice, that's the rhythm for the novel. And if there was an origin moment for the novel itself, that was that time when I that line popped up in my head.
Now, if I'm understanding you correctly, the stories then that you wrote, are these stories now in The Refugees?
Right. And although they were really horrible to write, they're really easy to read. Let me emphasize that. Okay.
So hard writing makes easy reading.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? That's the. So it's in some ways, I suppose what we see with you is a novel that was produced after the stories, which have appeared after the novel, but also after this nonfiction book. Mm-hmm. And for you, first
these
essays.
It's actually quite similar, yeah. And then the novel that I actually wrote first came out after that.
Right, and
it makes me wish that, you know, like in the year 2000, you and I could have had a chat about what we were up to, and then been like, you know, 17 years later, we're gonna be talking. It would have felt so unreal.
But, you know, I think our trajectory actually sort of makes sense, because having the second book come out first, it's probably a better strategy, because it's probably a better book. Would you think? Do you agree?
For me?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, okay, well, then
book
it's for
is
me.
The best
okay.
one.
All right.
They're all just going to get better. Well, yeah, I guess that is what you're saying.
What is it like to, what is it, so one thing that's interesting is I suppose there's a mirroring, it's inexact, but it's interesting that I'm, that you've sort of picked up on, which I was interested in pursuing in this Q&A. What is it like to return to material in a different form? So in your case, you wrote this book of nonfiction after first writing the novel. In your case, a novel after first writing this book of nonfiction. Mm-hmm. What expressive, what did you go back for, in a sense? Can you address that?
Well, when you're writing nonfiction, what you're writing is really like a little piece of something that's part of the whole true story of the world and of history. And people who you mention are, you know, they're real people, and you're not going to exhaust everything that you say about them because there's their whole existence and everything else. And when you write about your interactions with other people, that person's story of themselves trumps whatever you could see. You can't have the last word on that person. Whereas in fiction, all of those characters only exist within the space of the world that you've made. That's all you know about them. That's all that's knowable about them. You have kind of the last, so you know them in a way much more than you know the characters in nonfiction. So there's parts of The Possessed where you can see, if you read both books, that there are certain characters who you can see that there were sort of prototype-like characters who appear in The Possessed. And those people, when I look at those characters, like Ivan in The Idiot, there's a character, or I don't know if it's right to call him a character, the person Valia, who shows up in The Possessed, who's there for a very short time. But they're different. I know Ivan. I don't know everything about him, but I know a lot more about him than I know about this real person who I had a slight interaction with a long time ago that I wrote in The Possessed. So it's a different relationship to the world and a different relationship to the people you're writing about, and also a different relationship to yourself. I think you can be, as you said, more emotional. I did find writing the novel much more emotional and freer than working with a nonfiction persona. Eventually, it took a while to get there.
After I finished the novel, it had a big impact on my nonfiction, but not on the short stories. I mean, basically what happened was I finished the novel, then we had about 15 months before it would get published. Mm-hmm. So in that 15-month period, I wrote Nothing Ever Dies. And I'd already done a lot of research for that book. But what the impact that the novel had on that book was that it taught me about how to use emotion in my writing and narrative. So that it's a nonfiction book, but I bring to it all the whatever talents I have as a novelist to tell a story and to inject some of my own autobiography and my emotion into that. So it made me into a better critic, a better scholar. The short stories, after the nonfiction book was done, we had these short stories, and my agent, the wise man, sent it in to my editor. And my editor, very brilliant young man, Peter Blackstock, and I said, Peter, look, I have no opinion on these stories. I trust you because you bought my book, so you must be smart. So I trust you to tell me whether or not these stories are any good or not.
Peter's a wonderfully smart man.
He's a very smart man, okay? Yeah, and he said, oh, I think they're, in his charming English accent, I think they're good. And I thought, okay, if you think so, then let's publish it. But if he had told me, I think they're bad, or actually, Peter just would not have said anything. And the silence would have told me everything.
That's the New York way.
And that's the Hollywood way, too, as a matter of fact. Yeah. And so if he had said nothing, I had actually resigned myself to thinking, okay, these stories will never see the light of day. And while that would have crushed me a few years ago, thinking that I'd spent 17 years of my life altogether on something that would never get published, by the time I finished the novel, I thought, well, I learned how to write through writing those short stories. And so even if they don't get published, they've served their purpose. And while it was sort of a very miserable experience in those 17 years, since they're in my past now, it's all behind me. And as Nietzsche said, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
So I suppose...
You did say that, right? You did, right?
I'm pretty sure he said that. Yeah. It's the thing that everyone says that he said.
Yeah. Usually they don't give credit to Nietzsche, though.
They just say it?
Yeah. And then you think, oh, that's just a cliche.
Maybe Vince Lombardi said it.
Maybe. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe Wikipedia has it all wrong.
Yeah, maybe Wikipedia.
Is it even true?
I hope so.
Well, I think, you know, there's... The last piece, I suppose, that I'm interested in bringing out here at this point. It's interesting that both of you felt completely free in some way to pursue academia, or did you? Academia is not like an obvious choice to most people. And and so I'm curious about, you said backstage you alluded to feeling like you had no choice. Is that really true?
To go into academia?
Yeah.
You know, a couple of times in my life, people have said of me, you're a natural born academic. Which is like an insult, right? I mean, I think in academia, that's supposed to be a compliment, but outside of academia, it's not really clear what that means.
Even inside of academia, I don't know that it's a compliment.
Right, so, but I think that I was good at it. I'm good at it, you know? So I finished my doctorate early, I got a job right away, which doesn't happen to everybody. And so it's like just falling into that career track. And I could have ended up a very embittered, alcoholic, middle-aged professor, hating writers, basically. That's a stereotype, yeah. Right?
What are you getting at?
But I was saved.
Yeah. But you turned away, but you, I mean, after all that intense pursuit of Complet, in a sense.
Yeah, I didn't know about grad school until my senior year of college. And when I look back, it's kind of remarkable to me that I didn't have more of a plan for what I was gonna, because I knew I wanted to be a writer, and I also knew that my writing wasn't very good at that point. And it's something, like when you said that you knew that you would do better at a PhD program than at a writing program, like, as a young person, young people are not very good writers. Like, it takes a very long time to get good at writing. There's a lot of great poetry that was written by very young people. There aren't that many novels, like great novels that were written by extremely young. There's some, but there's not that many. And I was conscious of having this period of time that I had to somehow get through and get better and become good. And I don't know why I was so sure that was gonna happen, but I was like, I just have to not die during that time. And then I found out about graduate school, and I also was a good critic, and it was one of my professors who told me you should apply to grad schools and they'll pay you to go there. And I was like, they're gonna pay me to go there and just read books all the time? And she was like, yeah. So I did that. And then once I thought that I was just gonna kind of like buy a little bit of time and write on the side. And then when I got there, first of all, I found out that it took so much time and it was so kind of emotionally intense and intellectually intense that, you know, unless you were going to really just sit out everything and not participate at all, there was no way to do something else on the side. And I got very drawn into it, and I ended up, you know, basically writing that book about it. But I don't know, then it ended and I saw already that kind of idyllic, heady, kind of sexually charged time of learning, it already started to kind of fade a little bit when everyone started writing their dissertations. There was this amazing time of like the coursework and the seminars and the reading groups and the lectures, and it was like paradise, and you didn't have anything else to do. You could sit all night and you were all reading the same stuff. You were all reading, you know, some of the greatest stuff that was ever written, and the, you know, greatest professors from around the country were coming for free and giving lectures. And then everyone started doing their dissertations and everyone went nuts. I mean, like, you would see people, you know, hives all over their body. Like, it was that whole, the fun just, it evaporated very fast. And then people went on the job market, and that was another very, I saw people really damaged by the job market. Like, I know it sounds like a joke, but I did. And it, so by that time I was already publishing in magazines, and so I didn't have the I didn't have to get a teaching job, so at that point I just didn't do the job market, and then, you know, that life sort of went that way, and I went the other way. But it was nice while it was nice. It was really amazing.
I think you made the right choice.
So here are some carefully curated questions from the audience. Some are for both of you. Some are specific. This is for you both. What was an early experience where you learned that language, and in particular the written word, had power?
Power. I always knew the written word had. I don't know. I was an only child, and my parents were big readers, and they had, you know, they were both doctors and researchers, and they had journals all over. And I saw that everything that's important in the world is writing papers, writing grants. That's what adults did. That's what was meaningful. And in addition to that, my favorite thing was being read to, and then my father taught me how to read at a very early age, and I was constantly reading. I don't know when's the first time I learned about the sort of political power of the written word, but the fact that that's what real life was, and also the in a way it felt like another world that was more real and more meaningful than the world around me. Even the reading that I did as a very small child, it already felt like that to me, and that was already something that I wanted to be able to create. It was already kind of a magic trick that I couldn't get over seeing done again and again. So in that sense, I guess that was when I saw the power of the written word.
I just read an interview by Walter Mosley, with Walter Mosley in the Paris Review, where he says, you know, when writers talk about the key moments of what they read, he says they're lying when they talk about some kind of super fancy book that they read when they were older. It's really all the stuff they read when they were kids. And I think that's basically true. I mean, I think that really, like, learning, just like reading Curious George or reading kids' books.
Would you have answered that if I was like Proust? I first learned it from Proust when I was 26.
I would have been polite and not mentioned that. But you know, it's because I was a refugee, and I don't know how I came to read, because my parents weren't reading to me. You know, I learned how to read through teachers, I guess, or through immersion or something. But some of my earliest memories of the written word are books and bookmobiles, you know, little branch libraries where I was 5 or 6 years old, and I was reading these books. And by the time I was 10, the library was my second home. It was my home away from home, because my parents were working all the time. They weren't spending time with me. So the only emotional solace that I was getting was from books. And that was where the power of the written word was. I can't identify a sentence or an author, but just that whole idea of what books and literature represented to me, that's what set me on the road to wanting to write eventually myself.
And one felt loved. Like, I remember reading as a kid and feeling that whoever had written those words on the page had put them there, because I'm a writer. Whoever had written those words had put them there with this kind of generosity and love for the reader that I remember feeling and experiencing and wanting to create that feeling in other people, and that is very powerful.
It's a present for a stranger.
Yeah.
Okay, now we enter the sort of writer-specific portion. Yet in relation to the sympathizer and the refugees, what are the ways you would define ghost?
Ghost. Well, you know, I don't even like ghosts. I don't even know why I wrote a ghost story, because I'm easily scared, okay?
It's clear in that ghost story that you don't care for ghosts.
Yeah,
that's the ghost,
right.
The ghost story of a
But ghost, fan. You know, I mean, I like the definition there's a sociologist named Avery Gordon with a book called Ghostly Matters, and she says when ghosts appear, they are signs that something has gone terribly wrong in the past, and the ghost appears in order to demand justice. And I think that's right. Whether we're speaking about ghosts in horror movies, you know, saying, I'm going to talk about what you did last summer, or ghosts in this literary sense, that's why they appear. They're either literal manifestations or they're figurative manifestations of some kind of injustice, some kind of horrible thing that happened. And they want acknowledgement. They want recognition. And that's our job, my job anyway, as a writer, is to acknowledge those ghosts. I don't personally believe in... Well, I rationally don't believe in ghosts. I emotionally believe in ghosts. I don't want to be alone in a dark hallway at night still. But I think that, you know, I'm haunted by the past in a very important sense, that it's not let go of me. And that part of that haunting is the fact that I deal with a history in which millions of people died. And that's a very serious obligation, I think. And I have to figure out creative ways to try to acknowledge that and wrestle with those ghosts in my own writing.
All right, this one is for you, Elif. Who is the most overrated Russian author?
Who's the most overrated Russian author? You know, I don't believe that writers can be overrated. I really don't. I could answer who are the ones that I don't care for as much, but I really wouldn't say that any of them are overrated. If anything, they're all underrated, and you should all go out and read more of them because they're even better than you think, even the ones that aren't so good.
Dostoevsky gets beat up a lot.
He does. He gets beat up a lot. I was one of the people who used to beat up on Dostoevsky, and then I realized, I wrote a book called The Idiot, and then people started saying, you must really love Dostoevsky since your first book was The Possessed and your second book is The Idiot. And then I was like, I really need a way to answer that question. And then I realized that actually Dostoevsky is huge for me, and that the narrator's obsessive thinking voice is actually very similar to that voice in Dostoevsky, which is what people who like Dostoevsky like and people who don't like Dostoevsky don't like. And then I was thinking about Nabokov, who always said terrible things about Dostoevsky, like he just never had a good word to say about him. But then, you know, volumes can and have been written about the influence of Dostoevsky in the novels of Nabokov, and it's so clear, you can't argue with it. It was huge for him. And then I thought, so what is it about Dostoevsky that people think they don't like him, but actually clearly they really do? And then I thought, could there be a more Dostoevskyan feeling than that of like, I hate it, but I love it.
That was fantastic, thank you. All right. Viet, every sentence is electric. Do you write poetry? What poetry do you read?
I did write poetry when I was in high school and college. You know, I wrote love sonnets to my girlfriend at the time, And then in college, I wrote very political poetry, you know. But I think they were, I don't know if they were good. They were bad. Okay, they were bad. But the reason why I didn't become a poet was the same reason why I didn't become a chemist. I didn't know what I was doing. I took honors chemistry. I got a B+ on the curve. I had no idea what I was doing. And I wrote poetry. Maybe it was good, maybe it was bad, but I couldn't explain to you why it was one thing or the other. But when I wrote The Sympathizer, it was important to read poetry, actually, or to read prose that functioned like poetry. So Antonio Lobo Antunes's The Land at the End of the World, this Portuguese novel, it's like poetry on every page. I couldn't read more than two or three pages at a time because the images were so dense. And then I was reading Baudelaire, for example, just to see lines that were marked so strikingly by an image, because I wanted the prose in my own novel to have that same kind of impact and to actually interfere with the reader's experience. So I didn't want the prose to be transparent, which would be typically what you'd expect in a spy novel, for example. And so it was important for me for the reader to encounter a wall of prose because of the images and the rhythms.
Mm. All right, Elif, this one seems to be, it's a little odd, but we're just gonna run with it.
All right, let's roll with it.
Does a canoe appear in your new novel?
Why, yes.
That's right.
It does, yeah.
Someone is really excited. Do you want to say anything about the canoe?
Canoes are so like life, I find. you step in them, and they're stable and unstable at the same time, and how could you really write a novel and not want to have a canoe in it is what I have to say.
Thank you.
They don't appear in Russian literature or something? Is this like some kind of reference to?
You know, there actually is. I remember I took a I took one course in Russian symbolist poetry, and I read one poem, and the first line of that poem was, "O canoe of languor, O canoe of alarm." Or at least that's what I got when I looked in the dictionary, and then I was like, this is not the class for me.
Canoe yes. of alarm.
Yeah, O canoe of languor, O canoe of alarm.
Love that. And this last one is, I suppose it's more specifically to you, but I'm interested in seeing you both interpret this one. So for you, it's, was it difficult to incorporate what are generally thought of as academic ideas, such as those drawn from Said's Orientalism, into The Sympathizer as a work of fiction? And then for you, like, were there any intellectual ideas that you were also working with? But
No, it wasn't actually, although it would have been difficult 20 years ago, I think. If I tried to write this novel 20 years ago when the ideas of Said were still fresh in my head, I would have written a bad novel illustrating Orientalism. But I think that what happened was after 20 years of, on the one hand, struggling with writing short stories, and on the other hand, struggling with academic theory, I finally reached the point where I could bring the two of them together. And it was really important for me to do that. I think that I have a whole polemic against what I think of as middlebrow literary realism that dominates contemporary American literature, you know, but I wanted to write a novel that didn't do that. I wanted to write a novel that was very explicitly a political novel, a theoretical novel, and yet also an entertaining novel, and to prove that you could do that, at least for a certain portion of the audience. And so it was fun to invent, I had to invent a certain kind of premise, a certain kind of dramatic frame, and a certain kind of character that would allow the discussion of some of these ideas. But once I was able to set up that framework, then it was very relatively easy to make him be the voice of some of these concepts.
Yeah, I've thought a lot about the division between critical writing and theoretical writing and fiction, and I've been very happy in recent years to see that that wall between them eroding a little bit, I think, with more people doing things that that go over that line. And to me, what, you know, the novel is, it's the internal, the thing that makes it a novel to me is that it's dominantly about the personal, domestic, inner, interiority, you know, life of one person who, or, you know, or more than one, or some number of historically conditioned people. And within that, I don't see any reason why you can't have, you know, another way of thinking of it is it's a waste of theory to not have those things. Because the reason that, you know, people think that theory and academic writing is something that only, you know, 10 people are interested in and nobody else is in. But why are those 10 people interested in it? Because it's interesting. Like it takes a huge investment to learn it because it's, you know, sometimes it's written in not the clearest way and you have to read, you know, 50 things to understand the one thing. And it's not necessarily a speedy return on your investment. But once you do it, it's incredibly, it's like crack. Otherwise, no one would do it. It's and if you could find some way of conveying those ideas to people, anyone would find them interesting. And there have to be ways to convey those ideas without having to go to school for 8 years. I mean, I truly believe that. And I also believe that, you know, like I'm a person who has a lot of theory rattling around in my head. And some of that I imagine would be very hard to convey, but I think most of it is, you know, anyone could understand because they're a person. And because that's what's in my head, like, you know, the reason for putting it in a theoretical book would be because the thing connecting the ideas are other theories, but if the thing connecting the different theories is the subjective experience of one person, then I think what you have is a novel, and it can totally have theory and critical writing in it. And that's getting off my horse now.
That was a great horse.
Yeah.
Well, that's everything. Thank you so much.
Thank you.